Millions of people across the globe are suffering from food insecurity. What's causing the crisis, and could it get much worse? Hello, I'm Arnand Naidu, and this is The Heat. A combination of factors is driving millions around the world into food insecurity conditions, and the crisis is causing hunger and death. Part of the surge is caused by economic conditions made worse by the COVID-19 pandemic that countries are still dealing with. Add to that rising food and gas prices, plus a surge in inflation. In places like the Horn of Africa, climate change is also adding to the problem. The region is experiencing some of the worst drought conditions in decades. Meanwhile, the conflict in Ukraine and the disruption to food supplies has also had a negative effect.
We must do everything possible to avert a hurricane of hunger and the meltdown of the global food system.
Join me now from Nairobi to discuss the crisis is Christiane Rudert. She is UNICEF's regional nutrition advisor in its Eastern and Southern African office. Christiane, great to have you with us. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Let's start with one of the worst hit regions, the Horn of Africa, particularly Somalia. Millions of people are at risk of starvation there. What can you tell us about the situation and what people are facing?
Well, people are facing a looming catastrophe, and we, as the humanitarian community, the world, has a very rapidly shrinking window to avert this catastrophe. As you mentioned, consecutive dry seasons, failed rains over several years have driven hundreds of thousands of people, millions of people actually, from their homes, has killed millions of their livestock on whom these pastoralist communities largely depend. Crops have failed. Malnutrition rates among children, especially the youngest children, are rising to staggeringly high levels. We have some recent data from parts of Kenya that the rates of wasting, that's the most life-threatening form of malnutrition, have reached over 40%. And diseases are also threatening many of the people, especially in the overcrowded camps around cities where many of these displaced people find themselves. Diseases like measles and cholera and diarrheal diseases and so on. So putting very fragile communities who have sometimes walked for hundreds of kilometers through the desert to reach these places, and then they are bombarded with these diseases. Their resistance, their limits have been almost reached and sometimes surpassed, as I've recently seen when I visited Baidoa in Somalia last month, which is one of the big centers where displaced people have gathered to try and receive some kind of assistance. And I have to say, it's among the most difficult, terrible places in the world to be a child and a mother. It was unbelievable, the conditions that were seen there and also in the places where the people had walked from.
How vulnerable are children right now? How desperate is their situation? I mean, could you give us an idea of how many have died and how many are facing starvation?
We do not have at the moment validated estimates of mortality, but we are seeing rising mortality rates in the hospital centers where we are treating severely malnourished children. We're seeing the rates of admission of the most severely malnourished children with complications, often very young babies, coming into these hospitals. And, you know, at least they've reached, and some of those children from the remotest areas will not reach those hospitals. At the moment, we cannot say how many children and how many people have died, but we expect that excess mortality may be seen. It's too early to say what the numbers might be. What we estimate, though, in terms of the most severely wasted or malnourished children is almost 2 million of them. And each child who suffers from severe wasting is over 10 times more likely to die than a child who's not malnourished. So there are large numbers of children at very high risk, and we're very concerned about being able to reach all of them with life-saving treatment, and the insecurity in Somalia in particular, which I also saw as I was there, also hampers the efforts to reach every last child.
So what kind of delivery and support is needed right now? What is UNICEF asking for?
So the programs that we have focus on, of course, on preventing children from becoming severely malnourished, programs of nutrition support, but also health and water and sanitation, and cash transfers to families so that they can have a minimum amount of purchasing ability when there are markets that function. Of course, being supported by in-kind food assistance is also important. We have programs across the Horn of Africa in these areas of nutrition, health, social protection, and water and sanitation. We have managed to reach already quite large numbers of children with treatment, and the proportions who need treatment, who are being admitted, is rising dramatically. Between 30 and 70% more are being treated compared to previous years. But the appeal that we have issued for the immediate life-saving needs in the drought has only been about 40% funded so far. That appeal, where numbers have doubled just within this year, the amount being sought, being appealed for to provide these life-saving services has been doubled as the crisis worsens. We have appealed for about $260 million for the UNICEF support in the Horn, and only about 40% of that has been received so far, for which, of course, we're extremely grateful.
Yeah.
But much more is needed to avert the worst-case scenario of high mortality and famine.
Now, Christiane, beyond food shortages, what about things like medical care? Is there any kind of support there?
Yes, absolutely. So UNICEF and the World Health Organization and other health partners are doing their best to reach every last child with essential medical services, including immunization, especially against measles, which often will sweep through these large concentrations of people in the displaced persons camps, providing care for cholera, which is always a looming risk, and there have been some outbreaks, as well as treatment for common childhood illnesses like malaria, diarrhea, pneumonia, and of course healthcare services for pregnant and breastfeeding women. A lot of children are still being born in these horrible circumstances, and those children are receiving the care from UNICEF programs and programs by our sister agencies and other partners.
In 2011, Christiane, we saw that the famine in Somalia killed more than 250,000 people. I mean, how great is the risk that this could happen again?
The risk is extremely high. Many of the rates of malnutrition and disease and the numbers affected are even higher this time. So we are very concerned. And as I said, the window to avert an even worse death toll is rapidly shrinking. So the responses across the different sectors that I mentioned, food, health, nutrition, water, and sanitation, are needed urgently. They're needed now we still have that limited window to avert this worst case scenario.
Okay, that's where we have to leave it. Christiane Rudert, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
And for much more on the global food insecurity problem, I'm joined now by an international panel of guests. With us from Nairobi is Parvin Ngala. She is Oxfam International's Regional Director for the Horn East, Central Africa and Southern Africa cluster. With us from Gaza is Omar Shaban. He is a Middle East political economy analyst, and he's the founder and director of PALTHINK for Strategic Studies. And also joining the discussion from Santiago, Chile, is Maya Takaji. She is the International Officer of the UN's Food and Agriculture Office in Latin America and the Caribbean. Welcome to all of you to the show. Parvin Ngala, let me start with you. We were talking a moment ago about the situation in the Horn of Africa, but of course the food crisis is not confined to just that part of the continent. What can you tell us about the rest of Africa?
Yeah, indeed. I think there is a big concern, of course, across the African continent in terms of the impact at the moment of both what we are seeing in terms of climate change, especially in terms of, at the moment, unfortunately, with the Horn of Africa facing two-year drought, which has resulted, indeed, in the worst, driest conditions over 40 years. When you talk about prices, are compounded very much, especially by the climate change impact in the region. And so in terms of some of the work that we are having to look at in supporting communities, especially in the Horn of Africa, Kenya, Ethiopia, Somalia, South Sudan, where over 44 million people are indeed in need of humanitarian assistance.
Now, Parvin, of course, the Ukraine conflict has impacted food supplies around the world, but particularly in Africa, because we know that a number of African countries import much of their staples from Ukraine. There is, however, a glimmer of hope. Russia and Ukraine have signed an agreement which will allow the export of grain from Ukraine to the rest of the world. Let's listen to what the Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, had to say.
This is an agreement for the world. It will bring relief for developing countries on the edge of bankruptcy and the most vulnerable people on the edge of famine. And it will help stabilize global food prices, which were already at record levels even before the war, a true nightmare for developing countries. Specifically, the initiative we just signed opens a path for significant volumes of commercial food exports from three key Ukrainian ports in the Black Sea, Odessa, Chebonovsk, and Yuzhny.
So, Parvin, we should start seeing these exports in a short time, but what kind of impact is it going to have?
I have to say that, indeed, this the release of these exports cannot come any time too soon. Because within the region, one of the things that we have noted is East Africa's imports of wheat, 90% of them rely on the Ukrainian and Russian market. And so, as I mentioned earlier, with regards to the fact that climate change, especially the drought in the region, has meant that there's been quite a significant challenge in terms of food security. And at the moment, then compounding this in terms of the imports has meant indeed that there's an increase in food prices. And for example, in a country like Somalia, there's been a doubling of the food prices. So while food security already has been a challenge because of the drought, it's also become an even bigger challenge because of the food prices, because of limited supplies, as it were. So this cannot happen too soon, if you ask me. But it's also, unfortunately, I have to say that it's off the back of economic shock within the region. For example, COVID has really meant that many of our governments do not have the necessary resources to provide the support that communities need in these communities. And so one of the things, for example, in a country like South Sudan, unfortunately, we are hearing, or it is actually the case, that WFP has had to reduce, you know, food rations to communities because they do not have the necessary resources. So we see an unfortunate perfect storm where a building up from conflict, building up from COVID-19 impact to, at the moment, climate change and Ukraine being one of the conflicts that is outside the region, as it were, but has a hammer effect within the region.
Omar Shaban, what do you make of that deal between Russia and Ukraine? How much of an impact is it going to have on global food insecurity?
Well, good evening to all of you. This agreement is very important for two reasons. One reason is that the two countries who are in war realize the importance of to reach this agreement, which means that even under the crisis, under war, still the urgency of the food makes the two countries come together. Second, this agreement allows the inventory, the food, comes from Ukraine and Russia to the whole world, and especially to the Middle East. All the Middle East country, not only the Arab country, but also the other countries, are facing food insecurity, food double the price, and the majority of the Arabs, people are under poverty line, are not rich enough to pay for the food with the such higher crisis. And some of these countries have taken some preventive measure or measures to deal or to overcome the crisis. Some of this measure came very late, and maybe this way it will have very little impact, but it seemed that the Russian war with Ukraine has impacted the whole world. Maybe the situation in Africa is much worse, but in some other Arab countries like Yemen is extremely bad. Yemen, there was some truce in the past couple of months, but before the war, before the truce, there was a war for 6 years, and Yemen was described the most devastating, the most difficult crisis on the globe. 12 million people of Yemen don't have anything to eat. 12 million, half of the population, they are already going through hunger before the Ukrainian-Russian war. So you can imagine how difficult the situation is.
And what about the situation in Gaza, where you are right now, Omar?
Situation in Palestine is quite very difficult and quite complicated. Palestinian, there are 6 million Palestinians in Gaza and in the West Bank. Gaza is under Israeli blockade. Many Palestinians could not get out, and there is a huge shortage of food. Two-thirds of the Palestinians in Gaza live under poverty, and the employment rate is much higher than that. The Palestinian territories in Gaza, West Bank, they produce only 10% of what they need. Palestinian consumption, around 800,000 tons of grain and food in a year, they produce only 10%. What is more difficult is that around 60% of the Palestinian land in the West Bank under the Israeli security control. The Palestinian Authority doesn't have very much control over this land, over the water, over the land, which make it difficult. This requires, by necessity, a coordination among Palestinian Authority and the Israeli government and Hamas de facto, who are controlling the Gaza Strip. Situation in Gaza is very, very difficult. Mm-hmm. We are under blockade. There has been blockade for 15 years, and Gaza was subjected to 4 wars. The last escalation was in May 2021, where 1,500 housing units were destroyed.
Maya Takaji, what about the situation in Latin America and the Caribbean? Of course, that's a region that's been hit by COVID as well, but it's also a place where many countries are facing a very tough economic climate.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity. So just to say, we are facing a sequence of crises since 2008, actually, since the financial crisis. If you say, if you see now the graphs of the GDP, since then, our GDP growth has been declining. And the pandemic dropped down very hard. Now that we were starting to recover in 2001, then we have the impact of the crisis in the beginning of 2002, and the impact of inflation. Yes, it's been hit hard. The region, the Latin American, the Caribbean region, also, if you look at the impact of the pandemic into the food security and nutrition, we recently, now together with other agencies, UNICEF, WFP, IFAD, and WHO, we released the new SOFI, which is the state of food security and nutrition in the world. And it showed that the Latin American region was faced the highest jump in food insecurity in 2020, and the situation continues to increase. But still, the data that we just released doesn't reflect the impact of the inflation, food inflation and the war, which happens this year. So we expect things to get worse. So of course now we have 86% of the population in the region facing undernourishment. And one quarter of the population in the region facing food insecurity, which is a different, let's say, measure, which measures a bit the perception of the populations in terms of how they feel they will, they can have access to a healthy food or food
right.
in the next week. So it's one quarter. But we can say some countries facing, like Haiti, 80% of mm-hmm. the population under food insecurity. Also, we have Bolivia, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Honduras, Ecuador, close to 50% of yeah. the population in this situation. So yes, it's been hard hit, and we also are seeing riots due to that in some of those countries, mm-hmm. Justifiably, of course,
yeah.
because where we were already facing the situation due to informal jobs, no, the impact of the pandemic, and now with the food prices, mm-hmm. it's just getting worse.
You mentioned those countries a moment ago in Central and Latin America. I want to look at the situation in Brazil. Of course, it's the biggest country on the continent. It's also the biggest economy. There was a report out recently which said that hunger in Brazil has surged by 73% over the last 2 years, and that there are 33 million people now living in hunger in Brazil. What can you tell us about the crisis there, and how much of a setback is it for Brazil? Because this is a country that has had some success with alleviating poverty.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate. So this this data that shows 33 million people in food insecurity is a survey that was made this year. Let's say it reflects in part the effect of the war, of the food prices. So yes, it's worse than what we showed in the 2021 data. Mm-hmm. But yes, it is hard because we are seeing a lot that it is affecting all levels of income. Mm-hmm. It's not only the most poor. So all the population needs to be adjusted to having less income to buy food.
Right.
And we can also see that the levels of food insecurity related to obesity or overweight also increase because you decrease the quality of the food.
Yeah.
We are seeing scenes, it's kind of 20 years.
Okay.
Back in the region. But so just to say, I think you haven't been seeing it in the news, but we've right. been seeing scenes that we never saw in terms of queues when the people might buy meat bones.
Okay.
Or milk, let's say, almost milk, which is, it's not milk, it's the remaining of the milk. People yeah. are buying those things.
Okay. I want
to be able to feed their children.
Right. I want to get back to Parvin and Ngala. Parvin, you are with Oxfam. What are the biggest challenges facing an organization like Oxfam, and how is the international community responding?
Thanks for that question. At the moment, there are various things that I would say are really important, especially when you look at the challenges around the food crisis within the Horn of Africa and Eastern Africa region, and unfortunately, actually, across the continent. One of the things we are struggling with is the fact that with climate change, we are seeing bigger and bigger impacts, more frequencies in terms of the extreme weather events. And this has meant that we need to take a different approach to how we deal with this. So, for example, one of the things we shared in 2011, unfortunately, we saw 250,000 people die because of the drought and the famine then. And one of the things we then learned from that unfortunate time was that we needed to be able to invest early, look at the early warning systems, and also respond early, you know. And at the moment, one of the things that we are seeing is that in terms of the UN appeal for resources on this Eastern Africa food crisis, is that only 5% of the $4.4 billion has been funded. The other part of it is the compounding effect of the Ukraine crisis in terms of the attention, of course, that has gone towards the Ukraine crisis. And that has meant in itself also some of our partners looking at diverting resources to support those communities.
Right.
And as a, as an organization, what we have been saying is that it's not an either or. Indeed, it is about and looking at the various issues that are going on across the globe and how we support communities at this time. The last thing that I would say is in terms of the long-term engagement around this. I know that, for example, at the we're expecting the COP27 to discussions to come at the end of this year, where we are looking at climate finance. Many of our governments on the African continent are struggling in terms of the type of finance that is needed to deal with climate change in their communities. And as we speak, you know, in terms of carbon emissions, Africa only produces less than 4% of the global carbon emissions. And one of the things we have been advocating is for climate finance to be able to support communities, not just in terms of humanitarian assistance, but also in terms of the long-term issues, because as we speak, climate change is on a trajectory that means many people, including on the African continent, will be facing these kinds of emergencies, disasters, and on a bigger scale as we go over the years.
Okay, Omar Shaban, I've only got less than a minute left, but I want to look at the situation in Lebanon. The United Nations says more than 2 million people in that country are vulnerable there. And of course, it's a country that also has large numbers of Syrian refugees there right now. The economy in that country is expected to contract by about 6% this year. What can you tell us about the situation there?
The big problem here that many of the Middle East countries, especially the Arab countries, mainly Lebanon, has been going through political crisis. There was no government. It's not about lack of resources. It's not lack about it's not lack of the agricultural land. It's about a problem in the management of the resources of the country. Lebanon has inventory of wheat for 1.5 months only. And the Central Bank of Lebanon is facing a huge problem. They don't have enough cash to buy wheat. So it's not about the availability, it's also about the affordability. Egypt has 110 million population. They do have a lot of land that have not been used. And this is also applied to Morocco, to Tunisia, to Palestine. I want to say at the end of the day, this war in Russia, on Ukraine, has reminded us that with the need of the policy reform to make real development and to describe or to divide the land among different type of crops.
Okay. And that's where we have to leave it. Thanks to all of you for being with us. And that's it for this edition of The Heat. I'm Arend Naidu in Washington, D.C. Thanks for watching.